Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on the topic of martingale theory. In this video, I'm going to state and prove the first important theorem in the theory of martingale called the optional sobbing theorem. There are several versions of this theorem. I'm going to prove two of those versions that are two important versions that we can use in application. And so to motivate this theorem, so we are going to assume that Xn is a super martingale. Again, we need to specify with respect to which filtration. So I'm going to again call the filtration Gn. So with respect to a filtration Gn. But again, in application, it turns out that we don't really worry about that because we are going to deal with just processes like that are super martingale, some martingale or martingale with respect to their natural filtration. The reason why I'm only looking at super martingale is because everything I'm going to talk about easily extends to some martingales. The proofs are exactly the same. You just have to switch all the inequalities I'm going to write. And because a martingale is both a super martingale and a martingale, again, everything I'm going to talk about is also true for martingales, but all the inequalities are replaced by equalities. So now let's look at, to motivate the theorem, the first step is to look at how the expected value of Xn evolves in time. So if you look at the expected value of Xn, well, you can write this by properties of the conditional expectation. You know that the expected value of a random variable is also equal to the expected value of the conditional expectation of this random variable with respect to whatever. And so in particular, you can write that this is equal to the expected value of the conditional expectation of Xn given Gn minus 1. But by property of a super martingale, we know that this random variable here is less than Xn minus 1. And by monotonicity of the expected value, this means that this expected value here is going to be less than the expected value of Xn minus 1. So we have that this is less than the expected value of Xn minus 1. And then by a basic induction, you can repeat that here and so on. You can easily prove that this is also less than the expected value of Xn minus 2, and so on, up to expected value of X0. Expected value of X0 can be just X0 itself in case you start from a fixed deterministic value. And so, this tells you that when the expected value at time n just is decreasing, and in particular it's less than the expected value of x0. Now the question which motivates the optional stopping theorem, so question, is it true for random time? Random times. So by that I mean that instead of looking at the expected value of Xn at some fixed time n, what if we look at expected value of X capital T, let's say, where capital T is going to be a random time. Okay? And why is it interesting? Well, because you can think again in terms of games. And you can think of Xn as the winning of a gambler after the gambler plays n games. And you can think that the gambler is going to stop playing, not at a fixed time, but the gambler is going to stop playing after, for instance, when the gambler has no more money, or the gambler has reached a target, or the gambler might keep playing as long as she feels lucky, but stop when she feels unlucky. So it seems that the time at which the gambler is going to stop playing is going to be random and based on the past. So that's what motivates, kind of, that's one of the possible motivations of the theorem. is it still true that for a super martingale, the expected value of the process at a random time is going to be less than the expected value of x0? The answer is in fact no in general, but it turns out that it's going to be true in a few contexts. But the first condition we want is that this random time is in fact a stopping time with respect to the same filtration. So I'm going to define this notion, and you will see that again in the context of game that completely makes sense. A random time t is going to be a stopping time if the decision of the gambler to stop playing at time t can only be based on the past and including the present but not on the future. So let me define this. So let's say that a random variable t, so that something that is going to be defined on the set of all realization that we typically call omega, and with value in something I'm going to call n bar, that's just the set of all the non-negative integer, but also including infinity, because a random time can be, stopping time can be infinite. So this, and we have n union infinity. So this thing is a stopping time. With respect to the filtration gn, okay? If, so the condition you want is that the event that t is equal to n, so again you can think of the event that the gambler is going to decide to stop playing at time n should only depend on gn, okay? So, and we write this like that, if the event t equals n belongs, is a set, is an event in the sigma algebra GL. So again, this means that the decision of stopping playing at time n should only depend on what the gambler learns from time 0 to time n and cannot be based on the future. So again, in mathematics, we can do whatever we want. We can find some like weird random time that would depend on the future, but in terms of application, that makes sense to assume that you want to stop the process based on your knowledge so far, not on a knowledge of the future that doesn't exist yet. So that's the definition of stopping time. And so the most common stopping time we are going to use in practice are the following. It's called heating times. So that's defined as the first time the process is going to heat some set. And in this case, we think really of the natural filtration of the process. Let's give an example. An example of stopping time is, for instance, if you call t the first time, so infimum of n, such that your process xn belongs to a Borel set B. Okay, B is just a subset of the state space that we assume to be measurable. So it turns out that this is an example of stopping time. How do we prove this? When you just look at this event here, and you just say that, well, the event that t equals n is exactly, so this means that the process is going to enter the set B only at time n, but not before. And so you can rewrite this as, let's say x0 is not in B, x1 is not in B, and so on, up to xn minus 1 is not in B, but xn is in the set B. You can rewrite this as some intersection of events, so that's going to be equal to the event that x0 is in B complement, okay, and the event that x1 is in B complement and you go up to the event that xn minus 1 in B complement intersection xn is in B. So you can rewrite this event in this form, but then, and we want to prove that this belongs to Gn, or just in this case Fn. Fn is the smallest filtration the process is adapted to, so if this belongs to Fn, this also belongs to Gn. And so in this case, you see that by definition of a sigma algebra, of the sigma algebra F0, F1, and so on, this should belong to F0, because that's indeed the preimage of its x0 minus 1 of B, so that should be in F0, but a sigma algebra is stable by complement, so that's in F0. The next one is in F1, this is in Fn minus 1, and this one should be in Fn, all for the same reason, but again, because the sequence of the Fn is non-decreasing, that means that they all belong to Fn, all those events belong to Fn. But Fn as a sigma algebra is stable by finite union in this case, so that means that indeed this belongs to Fn. Okay, so that's our typical example of stopping time we are going to use. Okay, that's called the heating time. So that's the first time you hit the set B. So now that we have defined all that, we can define a new concept, which is the concept of martingale, or in this case, super martingale stopped at a stopping time. So let me erase that. And we are going to state one first theorem that will be important to prove our two versions of the optional stopping theorem. So, definition. So now we assume that we have xn is again a super martingale. And t is stopping time. And we are going to assume that they are both defined with respect to the same filtration that I'm again going to call Gn. So you remember that a martingale or super martingale should be defined with respect to some filtration, same for a stopping time. So we assume that they are both defined with respect to the same filtration Gn. And then what we are going to call the process stopped at time t, that's a process I'm going to write xn exponent t, that's going to be defined as, well, it's just going to be either xn if you are not in at time t yet, so if t is larger than n, I can even put larger or equal than n, and but it's going to be xt if at the opposite t is less or equal to n. So this process just evolves following the process xn, but then is going to stop when you reach time t. For instance, if you look at the previous example I gave, where t was the first time you enter the set B, that would mean that this new process is going to follow the process xn until the process xn jumps into the set B, in which case xn maybe will keep evolving, but xnt gets stuck there. Okay, so that's this notion of super martingale or martingale in general, or martingale, some martingale in general, stop at time t. So now let's look at, before we prove the optional stopping theorem, we need one first result that we are going to use in the proof of the theorem. And so here is the result we need to prove. So we have already those same assumptions. We assume that xn is a super martingale for the filtration Gn, that t is a stopping time for the same filtration, and then in this case you can prove that this process xnt stop at time t is a super martingale. And so let me prove that. The proof is not very complicated. So to prove that the process is a super martingale, so what I want to do is I'm going to look at the expected value of xn plus 1 given gn, and we want to prove that this is less than xn, so I'm going to look at this minus xn, and we want to prove that this is negative. So the first step is by the fact that the conditional expectation is linear and the fact that xn is gn measurable, we can just put this minus xn inside the conditional expectation. So that's going to give us expected value of xn plus 1 minus xn given gn. Okay? Then next step. I made a mistake here. I want to prove this for the process stop at time t. So I forgot those t here. Okay, so then next step, you see that in fact those two random variables are going to be equal. They are both going to be equal to xt if t is less than n. So this quantity is only different from zero if we assume that t is in fact strictly larger than n. You see that those two things, even at when t is equal to n, those two things are equal. So we can, to compute the expected value here, we can add the extra condition that t should be strictly larger than n. So that's going to be equal to the conditional expectation of xn plus 1 t minus xnt times the indicator function of the even that t is strictly larger than n given gn. Okay, so again, the reason why I can do this is because if t is less or equal to n, like here, then those two things should be equal, so the conditional expectation is zero anyway. And so we can introduce this event. Now you notice also that if t is strictly larger than n, then those two random variables, it means you didn't reach time t yet. And so xnt is equal to xn, and xn plus 1t is equal to xn. So I can in fact remove those t here and come back to my original process. So now that I'm here, I can just also say that because t is a stopping time with respect to gn, this means that this event in fact is in gn. You can look at this event as the complement of t equals 0 and t equals 1 and up to t equals n. So all those events are in gn. You look at the complement intersection, it's still in gn by stability of a sigma algebra. So that means that this random variable in fact is gn measurable. Because it's gn measurable, it can go outside the conditional expectation. So you get eventually that this is indicator function of the event t larger than n, expected value of xn plus 1 minus xn given gn. And now we are done, because by assumption xn is a super martingale with respect to the filtration gn, this means that expected value of xn plus 1 given gn is less than xn, so this whole conditional expectation should be negative. This is a non-negative random variable, so this thing is negative. And so that shows indeed the first result in our slide, that if you have a super martingale and a stopping time both with respect to the same filtration, then your process stopped at the stopping time t should again be a super martingale. So now that we know this result, we can prove our two versions of the optional stopping theorem. In both versions, the assumptions are the same as in this result. We assume that we have a super martingale Xn, we have a stopping time T, both with respect to the same filtration Gn. And in both theorems, the conclusion is the same, which is the fact that the expected value of Xn less than expected value of X0 that we wanted to extend to random time is going to be true at time t, but we need two extra assumptions. So in the first version, we want the process to be bounded and the stopping time to be almost surely finite, while in the second version, we need to have the increment, the conditional increment of the super martingale to be bounded and the expected value of the stopping time to be finite. So notice that none of the two theorems implies the other one, because bounded is of course a stronger assumption than having bounded increment. But then at the opposite, having an almost surely finite stopping time is a weaker assumption than having a stopping time with a finite expected value. And indeed, keep in mind that there are random variables that are almost surely finite, and still their expected value is infinite. So now, how can we prove those results? So the proof is like the pattern of the proof is the same for both versions. I'm going to just write just a quick proof of both of them, where I'm going to skip just one step, and I'm going to justify this step. The justification is not exactly the same for both versions. It's much easier for the first version of the theorem than for the second one. But so in both cases, we want to start by looking at the expected value of xt and show that this is less than the expected value of x0. So first step, we can rewrite xt as the limit when n goes to infinity of the process xn stop at time t. This equation is true because we assume in both versions of the theorem that time t is almost surely finite. So this means that if n is large enough, then n is going to be larger than t, in which case this random variable here is just equal to xt. So indeed, this limit here is equal to xt. So we have this first equation following from the fact that t is almost surely finite. Then the second step of the proof that I'm going to justify after is the fact that we can indeed put the limit outside this expected value. That's a typical thing we want to do in measure theory or probability theory. So we have that the expected value of the limit is the limit of the expected value of xn t. And again, I'm going to use another color. We want to prove that after, and it turns out that in both cases, that's going to follow from the dominated convergence theorem in measure theory. I'm going to explain that after. And so once we have this, then we can just use our previous result that state that this process, the process stopped at time t, is again a super martingale. So in particular, by the first property we saw at the very beginning of this video, expected value of a super martingale at some time n is less than the expected value at time zero. So this applies to this process. So we can replace this, and we have an inequality by the limit when n goes to infinity of the expected value of x zero t. And then, well, last step is just to see that this is expected value of x0. That's easy. You see that this quantity does not even depend on n, so I can get rid of the limit, in fact. And you see that the process stopped at time t is going to be the same as the process that is not stopped, at least at time 0. Okay, even if no matter what the value of t, t has to be larger or equal to 0. And so at time 0, the two processes, the process, the original process and the process stopped at the stopping time, should both be equal, which means that here we have the expected value of x0. And so this shows the theorem, except for one step. We want to justify the exchange of expected value and limit here. And so to do this, we use the dominated convergence theorem. And I remind you that this means that we want to prove that we can find a random variable, let's say y, which dominates all those random variables in absolute value. So absolute value of x and t should be less than y, and we want y to be an integrable random variable, which means that the expected value of y should be finite. So that's easy to prove in the first case. That's almost one of the assumptions of the theorem in the first case, that follows from the fact that our super martingale is bounded. And indeed, you just write that for all n, we have that the absolute value of x and t is less or equal to this constant c, which is finite. And so that's the first assumption of our first theorem. And in this case, because we deal with probability measures, so measures with mass equal to 1, this means that this constant c is integrable. So indeed, we can use the dominated convergence theorem. And so this completes the proof of the first version of the theorem. Now, to prove the second version, we need to work a little bit more, use a few tricks to indeed show that there is a random variable y that dominates this sequence and that is integrable. So I'm going to write this. So the most natural candidate, okay, it's going to be, I'm going to write that x and t for all n, x and t is clearly equal to, so the idea here is to write x and t as the sum of its increments. Okay, the increments can be positive or negative, and I'm going to take the absolute value of all of them. And so eventually we have that the absolute value of this random variable is less or equal to the sum of the absolute value of its increments. So we clearly have that this is less than x0 plus the sum, let's say for k equals 0 to infinity. So I need a t here, even if we know that x0t is equal to x0. So plus the sum of those, let's say xk plus 1 minus xk. Again, we look at the process stop at time t. And here, we are going to call this random variable, let's say y. Okay, so it's clear that we have this domination. The last step is to prove that indeed the expected value of y is finite. And this part is going to follow from exactly the two assumptions of the theorem. The fact that those increments, at least expected value of this, the conditional expected value of those increments is bounded. And so that's the first thing we are going to use. And then after, we will see that eventually in our calculation, the expected value of the stopping time is going to appear. And that's where we use that the expected value of the stopping time is finite. So to prove that concretely, so we look at expected value of y. Again, expected value of this random variable is going to be less than expected value of this one plus the sum of the expected value of both ones. So that's less than expected value of the absolute value of x0t. I just replaced that by x0 plus the infinite sum for k equals 0 to infinity of expected value of absolute value of xk plus 1t minus xkt. Then next step, we want to use our assumption. And so I'm going to again argue that, I mean, use the fact that the expected value of a random variable is also equal to the expected value of the conditional expectation of this random variable with respect to whatever. In this case, I'm going to condition on fk or gk, because that's in our assumption. And so it turns out that this is also, in fact, equal, but okay, less or equal than expected value of the absolute value of x0 plus this sum from 0 to infinity of the expected value of the conditional expectation of xk plus 1 t minus xk t. And here, I'm going to write one more thing before writing the conditioning on gk. You see that those this increment is equal to 0 after the stopping time t. So I can only, it's okay if I just look at any k which is less than t. So we can look at indicator function of t larger than k. And here I still need my conditioning. I don't have much space left. So this given gk. Okay, and I need one more parenthesis here. So then next step is to do two things. First, you see that because t is a stopping time with respect to the filtration gk, that means that this random variable is gk measurable, so I can put it outside the conditional expectation. That's the first thing I'm going to do. And the second thing is using our assumption that the conditional expectation of this increment given gk is finite, and in fact less than a constant c. So that's our assumption. We have bounded, uniformly bounded increment. So that means that this is less than expected value of x0, absolute value of x0, plus, so this thing is bounded by c with the conditioning after we put that outside. So that's a c times the infinite sum of the expected value of this indicator function here, indicator function of t larger than k. And then you see that expected value of an indicator function on an event is just the probability of this event. And so eventually, I'm going to erase here, eventually we obtain that, this random variable, I mean the expected value of this random variable is less than the expected value of the absolute value of x0 plus c times the infinite sum of the probability that t is larger than k. Now, the last step is, you see that t larger, strictly larger than k, you can rewrite this probability as the probability that t is equal to k plus 1 plus the probability it's equal to k plus 2 plus the probability that it's equal to k plus 3 and so on. And using this decomposition, so you have a new sum, you can inverse the sum, and so you notice that in this sum here, we count the probability that t equals 0 never. We count the probability that t equals 1 is only counted when k equals 0. The probability that t equals 2 appears only when k equals 0 and 1 and so on. And so eventually you can rewrite this sum easily as the probability that t equals 1 plus 2 times the probability that t equals 2 plus 3 times the probability that t equals 3 and so on. And this means that this sum, in fact, and it's easy to prove that rigorously using Fubini's theorem, this sum is in fact equal to the expected value of the stopping time. So, which means that eventually we end up with having that this is equal to the expected value of x0 plus c times the expected value of t. Now, of course, this is finite. The c is finite, that comes from, that's the bond, the uniform bond on our conditional increments. That's the first assumption of the theorem. And this expected value of t is also finite by assumption. And so eventually, we conclude that this is finite. And so indeed, we were able to find a random variable y given by this expression, that's just the sum of the absolute value of the increment. This random variable indeed dominates all those absolute value of x and t, and this random variable is also integrable. Okay, it's non-negative and it's integrable. The expected value of y is finite, and from that we deduce that we can indeed use the dominated convergence theorem, and that was indeed the last thing we needed to prove the second version of the optional Stochastic theorem. So that completes the proof of both theorems.